Hey, this is The Lowdown with Lindsay Lohan. This is my chance to share with you all some amazing people, places, and things that are inspiring to me. I hope that each episode will challenge you, inspire you, and give me the chance to share more of my life with all of you. And today on The Lowdown, we have a very dear friend of mine and very talented actor, George Young. We'll be talking about leaving law behind to pursue acting, the dream people he would love to work with, and the lowdown on balancing acting and family. Thank you so much, George, for being here on The Lowdown. It's been a minute since I've seen you. I wanted to just start off for all the listeners, just ask you, how did you get into acting? What inspired you? Wow. How did the journey begin?
Well, Lindsay, have you seen this face up close? This is why I got into acting. No, I didn't realize we had a video call today. Sorry. I'm so candidly dressed and my backdrop is so not set up at all. I didn't realize this is on camera. No, but yeah, so it was always something I wanted to do. And it was something I never thought was possible to actually do as a job, as a profession. No one I knew growing up wanted to do that. It was all very serious professions. My parents, I have a Chinese, Malaysian Chinese dad, Greek mum. They're very strict on the sort of do your profession, do something, you know, low risk. And I understand that now as a new parent, as a parent, but it's just wasn't something on the cards. I just did it at school. And then when I was working as a lawyer, I was a lawyer in the past, my past life.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I'm 85 years old, so I've got a lot of past. So I've got a lot of other previous professions. But yeah, so I used to be a lawyer. And even when I was working as a lawyer, I was taking sick days. I was ill doing auditions and going to acting classes and stuff. So I was always like, I was the worst lawyer in the world. That made me
the worst lawyer. Were you really a bad lawyer?
It was the 2-year traineeship as a lawyer, and it's paid and you kind of qualify there. I did the equivalent of the bar exam in England and all that, and then worked in a London law firm for 2 years. But some of it was all right. But I rocked up to a court appearance as the representative for this client, and I was like 22 and in a suit. And there's like, they must, if someone like me walked up, like this kid walks up and think, I'm not trusting this guy with anything. And I'm trying to be over dramatic in court, you know. Doing a sort of
What I was thinking, Matthew McConaughey, or like a devil's advocate situation. Keanu Reeves.
No way. And then I was always I'm sure I was like I was in tears by the end of it, just to, you know, accentuate, punch that line, you know, and it didn't need that at all. It was for some rent increase or something. I don't know. But it wasn't. I was just being overdramatic, and that's my skill. As you know, we're us acting together, being overdramatic, you know, overdoing it is my specialty.
That's where we had a lot of fun, I think, on set. I mean, but that's crazy. I mean, what a transition to make from being a lawyer and going through school and everything to become a lawyer, and then just saying, you know what?
And my parents must have thought, wow, wasted all that money on education. And it's just, now he's just trying to be on TV and movies. Oh my God.
And this is a question. Have you played a lawyer ever in a role yet?
Yeah, I have. Yeah, I did. What? Yeah. In Singapore, one of my first acting roles in Singapore, when I was doing a lot of stuff in Singapore at the time. And one of my first ones was acting as a lawyer, as a trainee solicitor in a law firm, and I just came out of being a trainee solicitor to a lawyer in a law firm. And so I did the experience. I'm a very method actor. And so I did I'm a bit Daniel Day-Lewis when it comes to that. I have to do the job.
Well, another thing that I thought about, you know, when we were working together, and I don't know how you handle this, but I know you live between Taiwan and California, right? Because I can relate to living so far from Hollywood and the Hollywood scene and everything. How do you maintain that work personal life balance?
Exactly. I mean, you have to do it as well. I mean, and now with kids, it's very hard to do that. So pre-kids, it's very easy. Me and Janet, my wife, who's like a superstar in Taiwan.
Yes, I've seen.
Yeah. She's you should meet her sometime. Hopefully you get to meet her one point. I'm surprised she's not gate crashing this podcast right now. But
I haven't locked it.
She's here, she's here. She's around, but I think they're hiding. The kids are, she's casted with the kids. And my parents are here as well. So everyone's sort of entertaining the kids. But pre-kids, it was much easier. I don't know about you, but because you have 12 secret children that maybe no one knows about until now, but your secret love
child. Right.
Yeah. We'll name them later, but
not true.
No secret kids, but yeah.
There's no lowdown on that one.
Exclusive. So pre-kids, it was much easier because me and Janet were so used to working long distance. We had a long distance relationship. I don't know about you and Bada, but me and Janet, we had a long distance relationship. We were just video calling every day and it was okay. But with kids, you've got to get back. You've got to put in the time and otherwise you don't have that bond and you want to. So most of the time. But so it was, it's hard. It's getting harder now. And that's why this year, we're actually going to LA. We're going to California as a family to have a kind of base there for a bit longer, So just to give it a go.
Yeah, Janet
wants to as well. I don't know about, what's your plans really? Are you going to stay where you are now?
I'm going to stay where I am because I find for me, I've already experienced how it is to kind of work in California and live there as well. It was a different time for me, but just times have changed for everything nowadays. I find that I prefer to have my own kind of home that's a sanctuary to go back to. And really, so now I just really go to the States for work and family to visit my family. But yeah, I like having the balance of living far away. I think sometimes everyone has their different choices, but definitely I prefer to be far.
you have your secret bunker there where you are now and then your family's in LA. So it's kind of the opposite. It's kind of,
mine's
see your
in
family.
New York. So I always have, which is also nice because then if I'm working in California, then I always begin and end my trip in New York with my family, which is important to me.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's nice. But soon, if you decide if kids are on the cards, that it's weird. The transition, it becomes your family the priority is your own little family unit with, kids and stuff. If that ever is on the cards for you, it just shifts. I mean, I think your brother has kids, right? Or you kind of
my
see
brother
it there.
Michael has just had a baby. Yeah. Isabel. Yeah. But and they're lucky because they're in New York and both sets of parents are there, so they have a lot of extra help when they need it, which is something that I have to think about in the future. Yeah. Wait, your camera. Okay, you came back. You went off for a second.
Okay. I'm here. I'm still good looking, right? Okay.
you're still looking, George. Don't worry.
Okay.
So we recently worked on a movie together, Falling for Christmas, which was such a pleasure working with you. And we had so much fun.
What defines
how you choose your roles?
Whoever gives it. I'm not in your position, Lindsay. You get offers all the time. You have the two-picture deal now, sitting pretty like that, Planet Fitness ads left and right, Super Bowl. I'm not in that position, okay? I am happy. What do I decide on? I always hear people going, oh yeah, I chose this role and I like the director. If I audition and get the role, I'm over the moon and I will take it. So just whatever pays the SAG insurance, please. Thanks. That's great. So I'm in that position. Okay. So what do I choose? I have no choice in the matter.
Yeah. But so when you will have that choice to really be that kind of picky person, which is going to happen and come very soon, especially after you see the movie, because I've seen the first rough cut and it's fantastic.
Oh,
you're fantastic. Yeah.
Oh, cool.
And it's really, really, really great.
Thanks for adding me to your two picture deal. Thanks a lot for adding me as a term that I have to be in it. I mean, that's so nice. You didn't have to. And I was, thank you so much. And And I'm glad your listeners, and I'm glad everyone knows this, and it's a verbal kind of agreement, which is fine. It still counts.
So it's fine. I mean, that Thank does you. Count, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. Thank you so much. But yeah. So, okay, when I have the choice.
What do I get a call from Netflix? What other deals have you done that we don't know about with your castmates?
Hey, look, that's fine. They'll understand. It's okay. It's okay. Just one thing like that. It's fine. But yeah, if I ever get that choice, if I'm ever lucky enough to be, and then yes, of course. I mean, something like this. Okay, say Falling for Christmas, for example. That was a role that was, for me, was very interesting because it's coming off the back. I think we may have talked about it on set or at a dinner. Coming off the back of the last thing I did, which was this horror thing. I was being all very serious, even though the film has that retro campy kind of vibe, but I was playing it straight, seriously, and American and all that stuff. To come off that and come onto this sort of thing where I get to be a larger performance in terms of bigger and just, and for Janine and Michael, Damien, you know, the directors, to allow us to let loose and do whatever we want. It was a very different experience. Yeah, it was so fun. And ad-libbing, at the end of it, doing whatever we wanted, was, we basically wrote it, I think.
We're taking the credit.
No apology necessary, but yeah. But so that was a lot of fun because, it was such a, even the audition itself, I get to play this, like, up myself guy who's self-obsessed, nothing like me at all, which is amazing. And it was a lot of fun.
It's nothing like you. I mean, you're a very, very, very sweet, genuine person. The character is just really out there.
But performance choice-wise, I actually, usually, you know, as an actor, you're actively listening during the scenes, etc., you know, the basics, right? But in this one, between us, we had to do what we did. Of course, we had to be reactive. But I turned that down a little bit because he's so self-obsessed. So it was almost like he's just performing for himself. Almost, Tad, the character, he was so self-obsessed that I got to do that, and that's rare to actually go against what you're supposed to do. And I kind of played it that way and see how that came across. Hopefully that kind of gave something to it, the character, but yeah.
It does, and it's so refreshing because there aren't a lot of movies these days that have characters like Tad in the movie. You just don't see these fun, over the top, almost like people are in real life a little bit these days with Instagram and everything, mm-hmm. those kind, you know, the kind of influencers. See those characters in movies right now.
It's so true because, like you said, in real life, there actually are these people. We have friends, who you think, oh my God, this is like a character in a movie. Sometimes I walk away with Janet, you probably do about her, and go, this is larger than life. You know, you couldn't write a character like this, real person, because they would think it's fake. Yeah. So there are people like that. And I did the research. I'm looking at I don't have a TikTok account. I'm too old for TikTok. But Instagram and stuff like that. I look at that and I saw some influencer style things. And I just, it was always self. It's everything's, everything is just like shirt off, doing your thing. So I just kind of copied that, but no shirt off.
We were filming in cold weather conditions.
Yeah, but I still wanted to, but I just did trousers off. But you don't see that, right? It's mostly close-ups.
No, we don't see that in the movie.
Yeah.
Hey, we're going to take a quick little break and we'll be right back. Did you know that only 9% of plastic actually gets recycled? No matter how much we put in our recycling bin, at Grove Collaborative, they believe it's time to ditch single-use plastics for good. Grove carries products aimed at replacing single-use plastics across your home and personal care routine, like Grove Co.'s concentrated cleaners and refillable glass bottles. Switch to sustainable products for every room in your home. Grove Co. has you covered with safe formulas and refillable packaging that never compromises on performance. Grove Co. offers an array of household products, including homemade soy candles. Their vanilla, brown sugar, and sandalwood scents smell amazing, and it's nice to know that they're better for the planet, too. Join over 2 million households already shopping sustainably at Grove. Go to grove.com/Lindsay today to get a free gift set worth up to $50 for your first order.
Plus, shipping is fast and free. Get started right now at grove.com/Lindsay. Grove.com/Lindsay. Thanks, Grove Collaborative, for sponsoring this episode.
No, about TikTok. So that's a whole nother world that really I've just been newly introduced to. I mean, I did one video that I did myself.
Yeah.
And it was terrifying. My brother Dakota's girlfriend actually helped me do it because I was so nervous that I didn't want to mess it up.
But it's not live, is it? Is it live where you have to edit it together? This is how much I know about TikTok.
So you edit it. But then once it goes, I mean, and the amount of responses and how quick they come, it's very, it's a little traumatizing if you do it wrong. Your kids are too young for TikTok.
They're too young. They're 4 and 1. So I don't want to give them. I feel like my eldest son should have an Instagram account and stuff, as in I'll post stuff about it, but then I don't want to do that to him. You know, when he's older, he's got that thing, you know, so I he's got his own choice. I should get his Instagram handle now, maybe, I don't know, but Lindsay Lohan lover was taken. So
I had dinner with my friends and their kids last night, and they're so young, and they're talking about all of these museums and fine art and food that we should all be tasting. And one is 6 and one is 11 or 12.
Whoa,
and and they have their own Instagram accounts, and they're posting these like beautiful photos of food. And I'm like,
oh my God.
How the world has changed.
But we're the last sort of, I know you were like a decade younger than me, but we're this kind of lot, you still have the experience of some of your life pre-internet, right? So I mean, we're the last of that.
Yeah, dial up cable.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. I love that sound.
Most of my career, my professional career, was no Instagram. I mean, that didn't exist, which was a blessing and a curse when you think back on it. Because if I had that platform to use to have my own say in what people thought and what they said, it would have been a whole different experience for me. You know?
Well, you didn't need it. I mean, you did it just the way you're supposed to do it.
Yeah.
I like your throwback cap as well, the MTV cap. That sums it. Yeah, that shows where your head's at.
This is one of my
literally.
Last remaining baseball caps. Yeah. I have very few. I'm always stealing batters.
Oh, really?
So what are you doing next? What?
I just want to say true story about that. I was buying, you know, just cards and stuff for the cast, right? And I saw this cap in Deer Valley, one of the places we were filming. And there was this nice baseball cap. And I was thinking, oh, I'm going to buy this for Lindsay, and along with a note I gave you. And then I talked to Janet about it. And she said to me, my wife, Janet, no, don't give her that. It's not cool enough. It's not cool. It's just, she's not going to wear it. She's not going to wear it. I said, okay, fine, shit. Let's not give her that. And I ended up giving it to Janet as a Christmas present. So she gets hand me down. Yeah, she's very happy with that. She's, it wasn't cool enough for you, but it was,
sorry,
I thought it was cool enough for Janet.
Well, if it's cool enough for her, then it's cool enough for me. So there you go.
Okay. I'll tell her that now it's cool. Yeah. Now everyone's, now I should,
then
I should
ask Janet. She just really wanted the hat.
Sneaky. I didn't think about that. I should have. I didn't think about that. That's very sneaky.
So what actor director would you have your dream to work with, or who would you really want to work with?
I mean, I want to work with Quentin Tarantino because it's his last movie, only because it's his last movie, right? So he's going to do 10. I think he's either done 8 or 9. And so it'd be nice to get him. Right, to get him now. So maybe if you talk to Netflix about us because we're both going in together. So whatever let's try and get QT for the next one. But that would be nice, right? Exactly. I mean, what about you?
Machete, when I did that, he was talking to me. Robert Rodriguez.
Yes.
Yeah.
And he was there? You said he was
maybe
there? He was producing,
to,
right?
Maybe we need to tag team email Quentin Tarantino, you and I,
man.
Both.
Yeah, we should. Okay, yes. Say, hey.
You'll be closer to him. You'll be in California. You can just like show up at his house and completely start stalking him.
Just give me his address and I'll be there. And I'll get him a cap, a cool, like, not cool enough, but cool cap. But yeah, you have, you see, these dream people I want to work with, you know, anyway, but you've worked with alongside, you know, Robert Rodriguez, etc. Who would you, I mean, you've worked with a lot of people. Who is your dream person now?
I mean, I would love to do another Nancy Myers movie because I love Nancy and Charles Shire.
Yeah, I mean, so you just did the one, but it was two roles, Parent Trap. So does that count?
No, it'd have to be a second altogether. Yeah. I'd love to work with, you know, like Diane Keaton, Viola Davis, Al Pacino, Robert De Niro. I mean, the obvious. Charlize Theron, I love. I'd love to work with her.
Al Pacino, De Niro. So you got when you mentioned those two, because you got your New York connection, right? So is that
Jack Nicholson would be a dream to work with?
Oh yeah. Oh man. Well, that's just put it on the list. I'm sure that once you put it on the list, it can happen, right?
Yeah, I think you'd have to just put it out there into the universe, and then mom always said anyone's path that you cross, you'll end up working with. So that happened with Meryl Streep. It happened it's happened.
You've worked with Meryl Streep. Which one was that?
You have to keep putting it out there.
Which one did you work with Meryl Streep on?
Prairie Home Companion.
Oh, man. That's amazing. And did you learn a lot from just when you're acting alongside?
I learned so much from her and Lily Tomlin, and just by watching even Kevin Kline and Virginia Madsen, just everyone. They all kind of took me under their wing because I was really young. I was so young at the time when we were doing Prairie Home, and we all went to Minnesota. And I remember the first thing that we filmed was us sitting in a room, and it was just, I had no dialogue. I had one line and they were just ad-libbing everything. And they said, "Don't be afraid, ad-lib with us." And I was like, I just started ad-libbing with them, and the scenes started going, and Robert Altman just let us keep going and talking. And then we all ended up crying at the end of the scene. And it just was a made up scene. And the most incredible moment I think I've ever had as an actress, just with these incredible talents and great people.
You ended up crying, just like me in that court case. So did you ad lib? So you kind of, like, I know sometimes some people's preference, actors' preference, is to warm up before the scene starts by ad-libbing some in-character stuff. And then they go quiet, you know, they go action and then go into the lines. But you mean you were ad-libbing throughout, and
This one just kind of was a rehearsal that we just ended up ad-libbing, but we filmed the rehearsal, and then it just kept going, and it just became so happily emotional at the end. They started talking about, it was just like, I don't even know how it ended up that way, but I remember Meryl hugging me, and I was like, and we were all crying, and it was just really fantastic.
Can we see that if we watch it back? We'll know. Is it in the movie? Did it make
there's
it
a
cut?
Clip a part of that scene, but then the whole thing didn't make it. But then I actually ended up getting more dialogue in the movie, so I had a bigger role in the end because I guess they were like,
"Meryl Streep hugged you."
Yeah, I got blessed.
Was your actor objective in the scene? You know, actors, for those who aren't actors, the objective in a scene, you're trying to get to an objective. Was yours hug Meryl Streep? That was what you're aiming for?
No, mine was just keep up. Don't get stuck. Just go with it.
How old were you then? Back when you filmed?
I think I was 22, but I might have to check because it was a long time ago.
That's amazing. But I mean, that must have been so intimidating. But once you did it, though, it must have been a big relief.
I felt like I'd accomplished something great, whether it was in the movie or not. It was just like the most intense, incredible acting class by mistake that I ever had.
Yeah. And after that, it must be like everything's easy. It should, it would feel, it's like once you've done that,
everything felt like cake after.
Yeah.
Because it broke the ice in a lot of ways.
I heard from Bada, it was a struggle. Your fiance, it was a struggle with acting with me, but that's because I am like an emotional brick wall and I don't give. That's the problem. And I work alone. That's kind of my thing. You know, that's why I want to tell everyone, any director or anyone, I'm not a team player.
That is not true, George. Don't say that about yourself. People will believe you because you're such a good actor even now in real life.
Two things that go on now. I work alone and I don't like people telling me what to do. Okay, we can carry on.
Perfect. Wait, actor. I always have this question for, you know, people with accents. Would you, do you prefer to play a role where you have your British accent, or would you prefer to have an American accent or a different one?
My agents get very annoyed with me because every time they send me an audition, I normally go, hey, have they got a preference on the accent, or can I do the natural British accent? Because it is, most of the time, it's more freeing being in my natural accent. It's like, of course, because if I'm adding the accent as well, it's another layer, but sometimes that's a lot of fun because that it's like putting a mask on, putting prosthetics on. It's like it helps you, or a costume on. Yeah. It puts you into that character a bit more, and it doesn't, you know, it funnels you in. So it really depends, but a lot of the time I do like to play my natural accent, but I've been fortunate that I've got to mix it up and do American or, for the last thing I did before falling for Christmas. So I got to change it up, and I'd like to just keep adding the variety. You got to do it English and American in one movie, the Nancy Myers movie, The Parent Trap.
I feel when you're younger, though, you don't think about it as much. I think when you're older, you pay more attention. You're harder on yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Yes. Yeah, well, that's with everything, right? When you're younger, you can play more, and just the amount. I see it in my kids, you know, who I've locked out of this room, but I see, you know, I see it in them, just the imagination, and it's nice to see that because it opens it up for me, kind of. That's the reason I had kids, just to be a better actor. Didn't mean to have two of them, but no, sorry, Dylan, you weren't a mistake, Dylan. That's not the official.
Oh my gosh.
I'm kidding. I am just joking. I'm joking.
But when you have an English American accent, you just do it on your own. You don't work with anyone or anything like that. It just comes to naturally.
Accent? Oh, wait.
Not for the British.
For the American accent. Yeah. British, I don't.
Yes, unless
I feel generous and want to hire a dialect coach to for the British accent.
Yeah.
The American accent, I would work. I'd like to work with a dialect coach. If we have one on board when we're during production, that's nice to just sort of fine tune it. Otherwise I just do it myself, but I prefer that, obviously, to have all the tools.
Yeah.
I mean, would you prefer
I
that
agree.
As well?
I mean, yeah. Yeah. I completely agree. I think because you never know when you think you're saying something differently and it's heard and perceived differently from someone else. Even there's the sing song of a British accent. It's very different and it takes a bit to get comfortable with.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's always better to have someone, I think.
And for me, an American, it's a whole different rhythm. So I have to.
Oh,
so
there's
it's
so
nice.
Much slang.
Yeah. Oh, yes. So it's nice to have someone monitoring it who is supposed, you know, who's on it. Because sometimes you'll lose yourself in whatever you're doing. And I notice that in some, if I watch someone who's doing an accent, I notice when it's very high emotion, if they get very angry or something, you kind of can hear, you know, especially if you're if I'm watching someone who's doing an American accent who's British, I can hear it when, say, they get very angry. I'm not going to name names, people who are failing in the accent problem. But no, I heard it. And so it's nice to have someone to catch it if you need to. I was going to say the Parent Trap thing. It reminded me. So the first time I saw you on set, you were with Cody, your brother Cody Dakota, Cody, and Bardo was there, and Janine was there. We were all watching the monitor. You were watching the monitor, and Cord was there as well. Cord Overstreet. So you're all watching the monitor, and you were seeing your stunt double. Stroke stand-in do a trip up on
the first day it snowed too, like really lightly
snowed. But there was a lot of fake
fake snow was there too, but it was really snowy.
I rocked up and I hadn't worked there yet. It was I was working the next day, and I saw you guys. Okay, and I'm meeting you guys for the first time, super nervous, and so your family's there as well, Eliana I think as well. So you're all standing there by the monitor, and I go, oh, hi guys. And uh, I, you said something. I said, I think, just to try and break the ice, I said, oh, wow, you're standing. I mean, from this wide angle, it's so, you're standing, it looks like you, you know, in terms of it, they did such a good job, right? No, and then you said, yeah, there's two of me. And I was going to go, I knew the Parent Trap was real. And that was what I didn't say. So I, in my head, it was shouting in my head, just say it. Say it, I knew the Parent Trap. But then I thought, oh shit, what if she doesn't like, you know, doesn't like everyone's talking about the Parent Trap all the time. Don't say it, George, don't say it. And I told my wife, Janet, about that night. I said, I should have said it, but I was too scared. And she went, you should have said it.
You should have, it would have been funny.
Okay, so there you go. So now I heard it now, maybe I should have, but that's, yeah. But you, of course you'd tell me that right now. Even if it was a terrible joke, you would tell me that, you know.
It would have been funny then.
Oh, okay, then I just met you and I don't want the second thing to come out of my mouth, a Parent Trap reference, you know. I just so I didn't say it, but there you go, now you know. That's what I was gonna say when I first met you.
. 30 million women are impacted by weakened or thinning hair. If you're among them, know you're not alone and that there's a solution you can trust to deliver results. Nutrafol is the number one dermatologist-recommended hair growth supplement, clinically shown to improve your hair growth. Nutrafol supports healthy hair growth from within by targeting the five root causes of thinning through whole body health. Nutrafol has three unique formulas to support women throughout all stages of life. In a clinical study, 86% of women reported improved hair growth after 6 months. Over 3,000 top doctors and stylists recommend Nutrafol as an effective, high-quality solution for healthier hair. You can grow thicker, healthier hair and support my show by going to Nutrafol.com and entering the promo code Lindsay to save $15 off your first month subscription. This is their best offer anywhere, and it's only available to U.S. customers for a limited time. Plus, free shipping on every order. Get $15 off at Nutrafol.com, spelled Nutrafol.com. Promo code Lindsay.
There's a game we're gonna play, this or that. Did you hear me? Can you see me?
Okay. Now I can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. All right, this or that.
Okay.
Film in America or film in Europe?
Whoa. And then how, I'm not sure I understand the rules. This or that. Okay. I don't have to say this or that.
No.
Okay.
You just
film in
America. Okay, would you rather go this? America or Europe? I'm asking the questions. You say America or Europe. You pick one.
Okay, because the title of the game is called This or That, so I assume I just say this or that, but that refers to both of them. Okay, let's go again. So America or Europe?
Film this. In America or Europe?
That. No, film in America right now would be nice.
Okay, comedy or thriller?
Oh, let's do another comedy. I'd like to do another comedy after Falling for Christmas. Why not?
Okay, Taiwanese food or British food?
Do I just answer the question? I don't explain why. I just keep going.
You can explain why if you want.
Okay, Taiwanese food or British food? Taiwanese food, there's so much variety to that. British food's great. I'm in England, and anyone listening from England, yes, but we get a lot of flack for British food. But yes, Taiwanese food, there's so much variety. I've been, maybe because it's newer to me, I've been opened up to it. I was just in Taiwan. And if you're ever in Taiwan, you and Bada, just come over. There's some good stuff we can take you to.
Robert De Niro or Al Pacino?
Al Pacino, because he seems the way he is so interesting. And I mean, that's tough, but Al Pacino. And okay. I'll do Bob next, you know, whatever.
Nike or Adidas?
Nike I've been wearing a lot of. So Nike, I'm going to say.
Okay, swimming or biking?
If my abs are popping that day, then swimming. If they're not, if I'm feeling a little bit puffy, a little bit bloated, I'll go on a bike. I'll wear tight shorts because I've got the quads, but I'll go on the bike if I'm feeling a little puffy. So yeah, depends on the day and the humidity, Lindsay. So it depends.
All right, plane or boat?
Plane or boat? Well, I just went on a plane. I'll go on a boat next. That'd be nice. Just nothing choppy, very calm waters. I get very... You are a jet skiing maniac.
Yeah, I like...
You love that. We're on that. We're on that. I'm just telling you, people who are listening, we got a scene where we're on this sort of, what is it? Snowmobile thing?
Yeah, snowmobile.
You loved every second of it. But they were going so fast on some of that, throwing twigs in your face. And my face, but your face mainly. And you love it. Yeah, it's great. So you'd be what?
I love that slapstick comedy too, though.
Oh, you do?
But I would say boat,
it's a stick that's slapping in your face. It's literally slapstick comedy. You can look more.
It's okay.
Yeah, you just whack. I want calm waters. Calm waters on a boat. That'd be nice. Catamaran.
Oh, catamaran.
Yeah.
I'm going to go
Not a super fast, but I would never go with you, basically, because it's too dangerous. Yeah.
Not even if it's like a luxury yacht.
If it's a luxury yacht, but I'm not going to be going on any of those little attachments that maybe you would have with the fast things.
I don't the jet ski. Okay, fine.
No, thank you. No, thank you.
Fine, you're not invited anyway, okay?
Okay, fine. Yeah, I'm not invited. Yeah. I didn't. Thank you for inviting me, and I respectfully turn it down. But thank you so much for inviting me. Okay, carry on.
All right, this is another little game called The Lowdown and Dirty. Okay. What is your all-time dream filming location? What would it be?
If I listened to my wife, it'd be Hawaii. I've never been, but that's sad. So for me, it's not reality at all. Is it?
That's
Stop
mine
copying
too, yeah.
me, Lindsay. You can't do that. You can't do that. If you've just had a brain fart and you have a mind, you can't just copy.
I'm Team Janet. It's Janet. It's Janet.
You're Team Janet. All right, fine. You guys in cahoots. So yeah, Hawaii, but I've never been. You've been of it, I would assume, right?
Years ago, I went with my little sister.
Okay, Hawaii, because it sounds great. You and Janet.
Just because of the energy there, and there's beautiful and peaceful, and they have so many spiritual aspects to it. I would love to just have an experience to work there.
Yeah. I would like to do a long running TV series, like 7 years, nice job security in Hawaii. Sounds great.
That wouldn't be rough. That would be nice.
It'd be quite nice.
All right. What movie could you watch forever?
Well, it's changed over the years. In my early 20s, it was Swingers. I used to watch that, early 20s, wanting a party all the time. It was the thing. I was in New York for a time, and we used to just watch that. 1999, we're talking about. So I was like 19 with an attitude. And it was just watching that as a pregame kind of thing. And then before we went out, it's so like... For really like two other guys I was living with. It was that was the time. It was good times. But New York with a British accent. Oh my goodness. Wow. That was fun. But now it's kind of, it's changed. What movie would I watch? I mean, apart from The Parent Trap, I can't think. Okay. Let me think. Cause it's got nice everything. Try. It's got American accents. It's got British accents. It's got everything. I just remember that one I used to watch a lot, and now I'll maybe if another one comes up right now, it's not Swingers anymore. It has to be, so it'll come to me. So let's say, what about you?
Yeah, I'd have to think about that too, because I have too many.
You can't ask the questions and not know first of all, you just copy one.
I can.
For one else, you just copy. You would be, is this
on you?
Is this what was you were like at school? You just sat next to the smart one and just copied what their stuff? Because I was
I was good at school.
Oh, you were? I was a bit of a chat.
I used to take notes for everyone in class because I loved writing.
Oh wow, so wow, nice. Oh, I wish I went to school with you then. That's great. Okay, we'll both come back to it.
Okay, who is your mentor or your idol?
Well, look, Bada is a new mentor of mine, and I just want to say now, if Bada, your fiance, I just want to say now that if I met him a second earlier than you, Lindsay, it would have been a different story. I mean, it would have broken up a marriage. I'm married and I have two kids. It would have been, but I'm sorry, but one second.
Sure.
The difference a second makes, eh?
Oh my God.
That's my new mentor. But my mentor is someone, whoever, like at the time.
He's one of the wisest people I know and gives the most sound advice.
Yeah. Well, there you go. You don't have to tell me that. We had a really nice dinner together one of the time, and it was just, I was sitting next to him, and it was so nice to chat to him and get to know him there. And it was, and I could tell, you know, he's a sage person. So, mm-hmm. so it was nice. So my mentors change. I'm very fickle when it comes to my mentors. It's just on the job, right? Say you're on the job, you're on whatever set it is. You try and you latch on to someone who has more experience.
Yeah.
So it was you in that case. And so, yeah. And I'm sure with you and Meryl, you know, you literally latched on to her. I mean, smart.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, so it changes all the time. Is that what you want to say? You're going to copy my answer?
No.
Good.
So what's the best piece of advice that you could give to actors who are aspiring to be like you, who are going to see you in this movie and want to be an actor?
I would say, first of all, be not only HD ready, be 4K ready. Your face has to be 4K ready now. It's not about, you know, it's about that. It's about the pore size, not about
your
talent.
That's the most vain advice.
Yeah. And secondly, I would say there's a lot of, what I've learned over the years is there's a lot of stuff. There's so much stuff out of your control. If you're doing an audition, just give your, instead of saying, oh, I got to get this job. I've got to get this one. I'm going to try whatever I can to take this job. Give a performance of your take on that character. I think Bryan Cranston talked about that once, and that kind of stuck with me as well. He didn't tell that to me personally. I should have just left it at that, right? It sounds like maybe he told me. Bri, he told me that. I took his advice. So to give a performance on that, I'm going to give this performance. They have so many factors, like in a TV series or a movie. Oh, we've already got a dark-haired guy. We've already got an Asian. They would put acting is one of the most discriminatory things in the world, right? It's ageist. It's sexist. It's hair colorist. No other job can you go, oh, he's not tall enough, or we already have a brunette. You know, there's so many things that are out of your control. You just do your thing, give your performance, and try and let it go. And you've done your thing. And that's what I would say.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't control it all.
Yeah. That's good advice. If you could go back in time, what would you change or do differently, if anything?
Before I want to actually know if you have any, because I would love to hear advice on, do you have something that you've learned like over the years? What would you say to someone like who's aspiring actor?
Well, I feel like from my perspective, it would be more on a personal standpoint. It would be more from a personal standpoint. Like I would say, really make sure that you separate your personal life from your work life and really keep your private life private. Because when I was young, everything was all out there when I was in my teenage years, and if I had preserved that, things I feel like could have been a little different, and I kind of gave too much of my private life to the public. So that's what I couldn't really have changed that then, because it was just became with it. So if I had complained then about it would have been like I'm complaining. So
I
moved back to New York sooner to be closer to family sooner. That's the one thing I would tell my younger self now.
So be closer to family, have that core kind of thing. Yeah. Okay, that's good to know. But the thing is, you were saying that you were giving a lot, but a lot of it, we were talking earlier in the podcast, you were saying this is all pre-Instagram, et cetera. It's not like you were voluntarily giving all of it. Maybe some of it, but paparazzi. This is like the height of that. It was taken, exactly. Here's me wishing for someone to pat me in the face, but no one's doing it. Here's me just waiting, but streets on the streets, pantsless. But No one's taking up for that for some reason. But thank God for Instagram. So there you go. So okay, that's you know, it's nice to hear your advice on it. I mean, to have that core family. It gives you strength, right? Yeah.
Yeah, because at the end, I mean, that's really who holds you together. I mean, is your family.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, important. I 100% agree.
Well, with that, thank you so much, George. Really, that's all I have for you. Thank you so much for coming on the Lowdown. It's been a pleasure having you here. And I hope to be on set with you again very soon.
Well, hey, we know it's happening. Everyone is listening and everyone knows it's happening. So I can't wait. The trilogy. The Falling for Christmas trilogy. I'm so pleased.
If it's not that, I'm sure we can find something else, right?
Yeah. And we'll switch accents.
That would be fun.
Yeah. Let's do
then
it.
Then you can just be my coach and we'll be our own coach. Hiring a dialect coach.
Yes.
And vice versa.
We're both just as stingy as each other. It's perfect. Okay.
Working with George on my most recent film was so much fun. He brings so much energy and light to his work and never fails to make me laugh. We talked about our dream actors and directors to work with and reminiscence on our time of filming Falling for Christmas. Whether it's a thriller or a comedy, George always brings no shortage of jokes with him. I'm so glad I got to chat with George about acting. If any of you out there are hoping to become actors, I hope this episode reminds you to make your dreams a reality. If you liked our conversation, do me a favor and send this episode to a friend. Make sure to rate, review, and subscribe to the podcast, and I'll talk to you next time on The Lowdown.